come down, right? Welcome to the evening service at Cerritos Crossroads Nazarene Church. And we're answering some Bible questions. And this one is one that comes up fairly frequently. Aren't Christians supposed to help people? And if I see somebody who's poor or is carrying a sign, aren't we supposed to give them help? I believe that the Lord will tell you which person it is to help and which is not. The young lady who was asking the question now said she was passing a person in the parking lot, had a sign asking for help, and when she went over closer, she could smell alcohol on his breath. And she was thinking, well, you know, maybe that's part of his problem. Yeah, that is part of his problem. But that's not a problem that you can solve. And giving him more money just buys him another bottle. So in that kind of a situation, I'll pray for the person, but I won't give God's money. I think it's poor stewardship. I won't give God's money to somebody who's, you know. In fact, one time, it seems to me I did this. Maybe it was... maybe it's just because I'm old and I'm making this up now. But when I saw somebody smoking, you know, my grandmother smoked and she was a wonderful Christian. You know, so smoking I'm not judgmental about. But there was this guy who was outside one of the stores and he was asking for money, and you know, he was puffing away. And I said, oh, no, man, I can't even afford cigarettes. And not everybody who asks for help really needs your help. And I believe that God will tell us. And sometimes he's really clear to me. There'll be times when he says, help this guy. And the light changes, and I'll keep going, and God nags me. Go back and help the guy. And so I'll get back on the freeway going the other direction and then get off at the next outlet and come back over and ask him what he needs, you know. But I don't think that's the case a huge percentage of the time. God will tell you. You know, one of the things... I'm really going to give a long answer to a short question. So one of the things that has always perturbed me a little bit is when people say, I think God's trying to tell me something. You know what? God's a big boy. He's not trying to tell you anything. If he's telling you something, listen. You know, he doesn't need to try to tell us anything. You know, he knows how to communicate with us. Chuck Smith, the one that, you know, is in the movie The Jesus Revolution, which I highly recommend seeing. But Chuck Smith used to say when somebody came up to him and said, you know, Pastor Chuck, I think the Lord has a message for you from me. And his answer was always, well, the Lord knows my number, so he'll contact me if he has something to say. And that was it. And that's absolutely true. The Lord has your number. He knows how to contact you. He will tell you, this is the person who needs help. There's one young lady who is at the end of a ramp on the way to my son's house. And when she's holding that sign, I can see it in her eyes. And the Lord said, she needs help for her and her children. And I'll help her. But not everybody. And certainly when you feel this evil presence, one of the things that God has given us is the ability to discern spiritual problems. And if she had the feeling that there was some kind of demonic influence in that, she needed to run like the wind, and she did. Yep. Any other questions? The Bible or the Christian faith? All righty then. That means that you want to sing. Does everybody want to sing? Make it loud.
Sing, O earth, his wonderful love proclaim. Hail him, highest archangels of glory. Strength and honor give to his holy name. Like a shepherd, Jesus will guard his children. In his arms he carries them all day long. Praise him, tell of his excellent greatness. Praise him, ever in joyful song. Praise him, Jesus our blessed Redeemer. For our sins he suffered and bled and died. He our rock, our hope of eternal salvation. Jesus the crucified, sound his praises, Jesus who bore our sorrows, love unbounded, wonderful, deep, and strong. Praise him, tell of his excellent greatness. Praise him, ever in joyful song. Our blessed Redeemer, heavenly portals loud with hosannas ring. Jesus, Savior, reigneth forever and ever. Crown him, prophet and priest and king. Christ is coming over the world victorious. Excellent greatness. Praise him, ever in joyful song. I know not why God's wondrous grace to me he has made known, nor why unworthy Christ in love redeemed me for his own. But I know whom I have believed, and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day. I know not how this saving faith to me he did impart, nor sublime. Life now is sweet and my joy is complete, for I'm saved, saved, saved. He saved me from every sin and harm, secures my soul.
The morning service here, they did the same song. So I guess the Lord wants us to sing this to Jesus.
And be held in sin's dread sway.
You know, at the very beginning of the book of John, it says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God, and then a few verses later, it says, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. That Word is the one we just sang that song about. And I would rather have Jesus than silver or gold or men's applause or houses or lands or anything, because all those things are going to burn. But the one thing that's going to last is my relationship with Jesus Christ. And that's what's going to get me into heaven, and that's what gives me joy today. But the Word is what we're going to study tonight. So let's pray, and then we'll boogie on through more of 1 Kings. Father, thank you. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you, dear God, that he saw fit to pay for my sins, to pay my airfare into heaven. And Father, I thank you that you saw fit to preserve your word so that we could study it and read it and learn more about you and learn more about Jesus. And so, Father, I pray for your guidance tonight. I pray, Father, that through the things that we read, we'll be changed. We'll become more like Jesus, even by the end of tonight's service. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay. We're finishing up, pretty immediately, 1 Kings chapter 1. You remember that one of David's sons, Adonijah, tried to steal the throne. His brother, Absalom, had tried to steal it before. And Absalom kind of got a haircut from a tree, and he was hanging from the tree when Joab came and ran him through. So that was the end of Absalom. But Adonijah, another one of the sons of David, wanted to take away the throne of David. David is very old, and he's about to die. He knows that. And so Adonijah is declaring himself to be king. And he throws this big party, and he invites all the people who had been faithful to him in the rebellion and had been unfaithful to David in the rebellion. And they came to the party, and there were lots of people there, and they're rejoicing, and they're saying, long live the king, you know, for Adonijah. But then his party came to an end, because he was hearing a lot of loud noises, a lot of shouting, and trumpets playing. Where you see, Bathsheba had gotten the word from Nathan the prophet that Adonijah was trying to steal the throne, and she went to King David. And she said, wasn't it your plan to give our son Solomon the throne? So why is Adonijah calling himself the king? And David was real upset at that news. And he said, I will make our son Solomon king today. So Solomon became the king before David even died. And now we're in chapter 2. The days of David drew near that he should die, and he charged Solomon his son, saying, I go the way of all the earth. Be strong, therefore, and prove yourself a man. You know, I'm not going to try to wax eloquent on this, but years ago there was a bumper sticker that said, real men love Jesus. And I can buy that. And real women love Jesus. And real kids love Jesus. And David is saying, Solomon, prove yourself a big boy. prove yourself a man by following the Lord and being strong and keep the charge of the Lord your God. And by the way, you'll notice that Lord is in all capital letters, which means keep the charge of Jehovah your God, to walk in his ways, to keep his statutes, his commandments, his judgments, and his testimonies, as it is written in the law of Moses, that you may prosper in all that you do and wherever you turn. Now, verse 4. David quotes a promise that he got from Jehovah the Lord God, that Jehovah may fulfill his word which he spoke concerning me, saying, if your sons take heed to their way, to walk before me in truth with all their heart and with all their soul, he said, you shall not lack a man on the throne of Israel. God's promise to David that there would always be a king on the throne of Israel as long as David's sons continued to obey God and keep his commandments. How did they do with that? Terrible. This is what's known as a conditional promise of God. God says, if they do that, then there'll never be a time when your offspring, David, have access to the throne. But they didn't. As a matter of fact, it was not long before they started disobeying God. Solomon started disobeying God, but right now, he's being pretty faithful. In 1972, that's when I moved from Albuquerque, New Mexico to Los Angeles to go to grad school. And I bought the very first color television my family ever had. I really felt like a hotshot. My parents didn't have a color TV, but I have one. And I had it in my apartment at USC. And I used to watch a lot of Christian TV. And there was one preacher named Garner Ted Armstrong. Anybody remember him? Yeah, we have one person who remembers him. His father was Herbert W. Armstrong. The son was Garner Ted Armstrong. And their church was the Worldwide Church of God. A cult. Not a faithful teacher of the scriptures. He taught, first of all, that you had to worship on the Sabbath, not on Sunday. And by the way, let me address that issue, because there are a lot of people who say, you know, if you don't worship on the Sabbath, you're not worshiping. You've got to worship on the Sabbath, not on Sunday. The Sunday is just stealing the Lord's day away. The reason that Jesus' disciples began worshiping on the first day of the week, on Sunday, was because that's when Jesus rose up from the dead. And that's what changed everything. That's what birthed the Christian church, was Jesus rising from the dead. And later, Paul tells us, don't let people judge you for days and seasons and moons and all that kind of stuff. You know, because one day is the same as another. I'm kind of glad Paul said that, because I frankly don't attend any churches on Saturday. I attend on Sunday. It's Sunday night that I'm sitting here speaking to you now. Do I believe that it's improper to worship on Saturday? No, I don't. Is it improper to worship because the Jews believe that the day begins in the evening? Is it improper to go to church on Friday evening at the beginning of the Sabbath? No, it's not. But who is our Sabbath? Our Sabbath is no longer a day. Our Sabbath is a person. Our rest is Christ Jesus himself. He is our Sabbath. That's scriptural, by the way. And so, but that was not That was not all that the Worldwide Church of God taught. They also taught what was called, what is called now British Israelism. Jeremiah the prophet had taken some Jews to England, ancestors of or descendants of David, and that they went to England, and then the monarchy in England, the many British people believed that that monarchy is the fulfillment of the prophecy that there would never be someone, you know, who is in the line of David off the throne. And so they believe, for example, that Queen Elizabeth is a descendant from King David. They believe that King Charles III, who is just went through his coronation, they believe that he is a descendant of David. And so there's never been a time when there was not a descendant of David on the throne. That's not the case. They taught that there were 10 lost tribes of Israel. Don't believe it. God has not lost 10 tribes of Israel. He knows exactly who they are, and he proves it in the book of Revelation when he says he's going to take 12,000 from the tribe of Reuben, 12,000 from the tribe of Gad, 12,000 from Naphtali, 12,000 from each one of the tribes, and those would become the 144,000 that witnessed to people during the tribulation. So he knows exactly who those people are. The reason that we don't know is because 30-some years after Jesus was crucified and rose from the dead, Titus, and this is not Titus, the minister that Paul wrote to, Titus was a general of the Roman army. And he came in and sacked and destroyed Jerusalem. Guess what went with it? The records. Those records that could prove, well, these people were in the tribe of Levi, so they can be priests. But then they didn't know who was in the tribe of Levi. So they didn't know who could be priests. So you know what? For the last 1950 years, there haven't been any priests in Israel, because they don't know who they could be. But God knows who they are. God knows who each one of the tribes are. The tribes are not lost. So don't believe it when you hear it. But after the cross, it's no longer important to keep track of the tribes. Not to us. Because Jesus puts everybody on an equal plane now. He died for everybody. And so we don't need to know. I'm not a big fan of those companies that, study your DNA and say, oh, you're 71% British and 22% Italian and all that kind of stuff. You know what? You don't get that from DNA. The DNA has been so seriously mixed over the last several centuries that that's no longer an issue. I have no idea what percent. Now I know my grandfather, as far as I know, was pure Italian, but probably not, because I don't think anybody on earth is pure anything anymore. As a matter of fact, my grandfather had a little bit of Persian in him. So I don't believe in all that stuff. It's not important anymore to know who's in what tribe, who's in what nationality. Folks, we are all one in Christ. Paul tells us that. We're all one in Christ. You know, a lot of my best friends are people that when I was a kid, I didn't hang out with because I thought they were inferior. I had, friends who were from China and other places. And I thought, the Chinese just want to nuke us. They want to get rid of us anyway. And so do the Russians. And so, you know, I hung around with kids that didn't hang around with those kids. And then I became a Christian. I said, no, wait a minute. Those kids are just like me. If they get cut, their blood is red. I used to love a movie called To Sir with Love, starring Sidney Poitier. And, you know, he was a teacher in England, and some of the students were bigoted against him. And he got cut, and one of the students said, look, it's red. And one of the girls who really liked him said, what did you expect, ink? You know, everybody bleeds red. We're all the same. I don't care how much pigment is in the skin. I've got more pigment in my skin than my brother does. And, you know, my mom had more pigment in her skin than both of us. And my grandfather probably more than all three of us. And my dad was white as a lily. All of that is meaningless. All of that is moronic when people say different folks and different colors and different backgrounds that we're not different. There's two races on earth, believers and non-believers. That's all there is. And it's our job as believers to go get some of the others and bring them over into the camp of Christ. That's our job. We need to tell other people about Jesus. And the best way to tell people about Jesus is by the way we live. So, the reason that the throne of David was given up at the time of the Babylonian captivity was because the Jews were sinning. They were rebelling against God. He said, okay, well, you know, the promise was as long as you obeyed me. And most of those kings did not. And he got tired of it and said, okay, fine. But there's somebody who's going to return to that throne. And that throne will never again be empty, the throne of David. Because he has a descendant many generations later. In fact, 1,000 years after David, a man named Jesus of Nazareth, who came from the tribe of Judah. And at that time, they knew who the tribes were. Titus hadn't come yet to destroy Jerusalem. He came from the tribe of Judah. And he will be on that throne. I don't know when. I wish I did. Maybe I'm glad I don't. I don't know. But Jesus will occupy the throne of David forever. Verse 5, chapter 2. Moreover, you know also what Joab, the son of David's talking to Solomon still, right? And he says, you know what Joab did. He killed two of my commanders, Abner, the son of Ner, and Amasa, the son of Jether. He killed them both. These were innocent guys. And he shed the blood of war in peacetime and the blood of war and the blood of war on his belt that was around his waist. He took a sword and he ran these guys through and killed them. And on his sandals that were on his feet. There was blood everywhere with Joab. He had served David well for quite some time. But then, when Adonijah rebelled and tried to steal the throne, Joab went over to Adonijah. But that wasn't what David wanted to do away with Joab for. It was killing these innocent generals. Therefore, David tells Solomon, do according to your wisdom. This is a great line, you know. Your wisdom means you know what I want you to do to these guys, but I'm not going to tell you. Do according to your wisdom and do not let his gray hair go down to the grave in peace. So that was pretty clear. He wanted Joab to be destroyed. But show kindness to the sons of Barzillai the Gileadite, and let them be among those who eat at your table. For so they came to me when I fled from Absalom. So when Absalom, his son, tried to steal the throne, and he rebelled against his father David, then this guy, Barzillai, was faithful to David. And so he said, leave him be. He's a good guy. But do you remember when David was going through a town, and there was this guy named Shimei? He was a son of Gera. He was a Benjamite, so he was a Hebrew. He was from Bahurim. And as David's party was progressing down the street, he was picking up stones and throwing them at David and cursing him and cursing all of those who were following him. And David said to Solomon, don't hold him guiltless. He's not innocent. And you're a wise man. And know what you ought to do with him. But bring his gray hair down to the grave with blood. So he told him pretty specifically what to do with him. And verse 10, David rested with his fathers and was buried in the city of David, Jerusalem. Now verse 11. The period that David reigned over Israel was 40 years. He reigned 7 years in Hebron, and then the other 33 years he reigned in Jerusalem. And Solomon sat on the throne of David now. So he has inherited the throne from his father. And his kingdom was firmly established, meaning he was a strong king. He obviously took David's advice when David said, be strong and be a real man. His kingdom was firmly established. Now, Adonijah, the guy that had tried to steal the throne, the son of Haggith, came to Bathsheba. Now, do you think that the guy who tried to steal the throne, but then his half-brother Solomon is sitting on the throne, and the kingdom is firmly established, how do you think Adonijah felt? And the answer is, very nervous. He's going to consider me committing treason. He's going to have me killed. And so he went to Bathsheba, Solomon's mother. Always go to the woman in charge. So he went to Bathsheba, the mother of Solomon, and she said, are you coming in peace? He said, oh yeah, total peace. I'm coming peaceably. And then he said, I have something to say to you. She said, say it. And he said, you know that the kingdom was mine. In other words, he was declaring himself to be king. And all Israel had set their expectations on me that I should reign. However, the kingdom has been turned over and has become my brother's, meaning Solomon's, for it was his from the Lord, from Jehovah. That's actually pretty good testimonial. He recognized that God wanted Solomon on the throne. So he says to Bathsheba, I have a request of you. She said, say it. And he said, please go speak to your son Solomon, for he won't refuse you. And he'll give you whatever you want. And tell him that I would like Abishag the Shunammite as a wife. You remember Abishag from last week? David was old. David was ill. He couldn't keep warm. They kept putting blankets on him. It didn't keep him warm. I can relate to that. And so his servants brought in this young virgin named Abishag from Shunem, a Shunammite. And she just lay there with David innocently, but she laid there to help keep him warm. Now, it's an interesting kind of a tradition that if you have relations with a concubine of the previous king, then you are the king. It was a sign of disrespect to the previous king, and here Adonijah is saying, bring me Abishag, the Shunammite, and let me be her wife. And so Bathsheba said, fine, I'll go speak to the king. And she went to speak to King Solomon. And the king got up to meet her. Now, this is a man who really respected his mother. He respected both of his parents. And when she came in, he bowed down before his mother. And she said, I have a request for you, son. And don't refuse me. And the king said to her, ask it, my mother, for I will not refuse you. Never make a promise that you can't keep. And she said, I desire one small petition of you. Let Abishag the Shunammite be given to Adonijah, your brother, to be his wife. What do you think King Solomon said?
Oh, yes, that's a good idea. Yes, go ahead and get right.
He said, that's it. I'm tired of Adonijah. He might as well be asking for the kingdom, which was true. That was the way they looked at it. So, no, he is my older brother. For him and for Abiathar the priest and for Joab the son of Zeruiah, and King Solomon swore by Jehovah, saying, may God do so to me, and more also, if Adonijah has not spoken this word against his own life. Adonijah, you've sealed your death certificate. Now, therefore, as Jehovah lives, who has confirmed me and set me on the throne of David, my father, and who has established a house for me, as he promised, Adonijah shall be put to death today. Does that mean I don't get Abishag? So he would be put to death that very day. And Solomon sent by the hand of Benaiah, the son of Jehoiada. Benaiah was kind of Solomon's hitman. You know, he would take care of all the people that David said to take care of. You know what I'm saying? And so Benaiah, the son of Jehoiada, went and struck Adonijah down, and he died. And Abiathar the priest, the king said, you are deserving of death, but I'm not going to put you to death at this time. And the reason was a good, godly reason. He said, you carried the Ark of the Covenant before my father, King David, and I'm not going to put you to death. Every time my father was afflicted, you were afflicted. And I respect that. So Solomon removed Abiathar from being priest. You're no longer a priest, but I'm going to let you survive. But when he was removed from the priesthood, that fulfilled an old prophecy. Remember when Hannah went to Samuel and his sons, Phinehas and Hophni, were just dreadfully sinful sons, and they of course were sons of the priests, so they were priests as well, but they were sinful. And so the word came to Eli that no more will his relatives be priests. And so the Lord fulfilled that. And Abiathar the priest was removed from the priesthood. Then, verse 28, news came to King Joab, for Joab had defected to Adonijah. Remember, he was faithful to Adonijah when he tried to steal the throne of David. And it says, Joab fled to the tabernacle of the Lord and took hold of the horns of the altar. Now, here's how this goes. There's something about Coke Zero. You know? Now, I don't get a kickback from Coca-Cola Company, but good stuff. So, when somebody fled to the tabernacle, remember there was no temple yet. Solomon was going to build the temple. So there was still just a tent, which is where the Ark of the Covenant was. And the Ark of the Covenant had horns on the corners, you know, of the box. And when somebody went and held onto those horns, he was pleading for mercy. So he had committed a crime, and he was just pleading for mercy. And so King Solomon was told that Joab was holding onto those horns for dear life, you know. And Solomon sent his hitman, saying, go strike him down. But Benaiah went to the tabernacle of the Lord and said to him, thus says the king, come out. And Joseph, no, you don't. I'm holding onto these horns. But I'll die here if I have to. And Benaiah, the hitman, brought back word to King Solomon saying, this is what Joab said, and he's going to hold onto those horns. The king said to him, do as he has said. Kill him there and bury him, that you may take away from me and from the house of my father the innocent blood which Joab shed. So that's the end of General Joab. So the Lord will return his blood on his head because he struck down two men who were more righteous and better than he was. And he names the two men Abner and Amasa, the son of Jether. And so they were avenged. And so Benaiah went and killed Joab. And then the king sent and called for the rock thrower, Shimei. And he said to him, build a house in Jerusalem and live in it and don't go anywhere. Don't leave Jerusalem. And Shimei said, So he built a house there in Jerusalem. He stayed in the house in Jerusalem until the day came. And by the way, Solomon had said, if you leave Jerusalem, you cross the brook Kidron, your blood is going to be on your own head. And Shimei said, that's fine, King Solomon. Good idea. But it happened after 3 years, he had stayed there in Jerusalem for 3 years, obeying the king, that two of his slaves ran away to Achish, the son of Maacah, king of Gath. You remember Achish was the Philistine king that David had fled to when King Saul was trying to kill David. And so he pretended to be insane, and he let the spit go down in his beard. It was kind of gross. But this is that same king, Achish. And they told Shimei, saying, look, your slaves are in Gath. So Shimei arose, saddled his donkey, went to Achish in Gath to seek his slaves, and Shimei went and brought his slaves from Gath. Well, guess who got word of it? Solomon. He was told that Shimei had gone from Jerusalem to Gath and had come back. Well, what did the king promise him? If he left Jerusalem, his blood would be on his own head. So he is now ready to show vengeance to Shimei for throwing all those rocks and cursing his father David. And he said, didn't I make you swear by Jehovah and warn you, saying, know for certain that on the day you go out and travel anywhere, you're going to die? And you said to me, oh, yes, that sounds like a good idea. Why then haven't you kept this promise? And the king said, moreover, to Shimei, you know, as your heart acknowledges all the wickedness that you did to my father David, therefore Jehovah will return your wickedness on your own head. But King Solomon, this is Solomon speaking, King Solomon will be blessed, and the throne of David shall be established before the Lord forever. So the king commanded his hitman, the son of Jehoiada, and he went out, struck down Shimei, and he died, and the kingdom was now established completely in the hand of Solomon. Now, chapter 4. No, chapter 3. I'm a mathematician. I should have known the 3 comes after 2. But in chapter 3, Solomon made a treaty with the king of Egypt, and he married Pharaoh's daughter. Now, do you remember when it was told back in the law of Moses that the king should not gather many wives and should not gather many horses? Solomon did both. He had hundreds of wives, hundreds of concubines. The total between them was 1,000. I know people that can't even handle one wife. I hear that, amen, and I won't tell her who said it. But 1,000 women, so he amassed wives and he amassed horses. He had 40,000 places and stables for his horses that would, pull the chariots and all of that. 40,000. You know, you'd think he would have been sufficient with 15,000 or 20,000. But he had a lot of them. And it's often told that Solomon was a myth. There was no King Solomon. That's just Bible mythology. And then archaeologists. Don't you love when this happens? The archaeologists went and they found references to Solomon by name. And they found hundreds of stables in different cities. Yeah, I'll be darned. The Bible seems once more to know exactly what it's talking about. You'd think the author knew. And so, but Solomon still loved the Lord. He was starting to disobey him. And he went to, the high places were places where the heathen, the pagans, would offer sacrifices to their god, to Baal and Ashtaroth, and they would offer sacrifices to those gods in the high places. And Solomon went up into the high places. But he offered sacrifices to Jehovah. And by the way, these peace offerings were not wasted meat. When a peace offering is offered to Jehovah, it's a barbecue. The meat is offered to God, but then it's eaten by his people. And so these were massive parties, they were festivals, celebrations. God's people should be the happiest, most cheerful people on earth. Because we're saved, our sin is gone, and we're going to heaven. I mean, what in the world do we have to be sad about? Nothing. And so they're partying. They're rejoicing. Now, Solomon went to sleep, and he had a dream. And in the dream, the Lord said to him, ask whatever you want. How would you like to get a blank check like that from God? Right? Whatever you want, you can have it. And so, what did Solomon ask for? What would you ask for if you got a blank check from God? Health? Wealth? Freedom from your enemies? What would you ask for? Maybe just getting along with your mother-in-law? I don't know, whatever, you know. But what would you ask for? Solomon said in his dream, Lord, you've given me all these people to reign over. And I just ask that you give me the wisdom to do it right, to reign over your people. Do you think that pleased God? Big time. And he said, because you haven't asked for wealth and you haven't asked for peace from your enemies, and you haven't asked for happiness, I'm going to give you those things too, but I'm going to give you what you ask for, and you will be the wisest king who ever lived or whoever will live. There have been no kings as wise as Solomon. Now, interesting story. And it's not just a story. This actually happened. That two women came to Solomon. They were both prostitutes. And they came into Solomon and they wanted him to make a decision between the two of them, because one of them, they both had children at within a few days of each other in age. Both had babies. And one of the mothers was lying down and accidentally lay down on top of her child, and he suffocated and died. And so they brought the living child to Solomon. And each one of them claimed, that's my child. The dead one is hers. And the other one said, no, the dead one is hers. The living child belongs to me. Well, God made Solomon the wisest king ever. So he said, here's the solution. Go get a sword. Take this living child, cut him in half, and give half to each one of the women. And one of the women said, no, don't do that. Give her the child. Because she was afraid for her child, right? And Solomon said, that woman is the true mother. Give the child to her. Wisdom. God's wisdom. We're going to talk a little bit more about it in chapter 4. But what would you ask for if you got a blank check from God? In Matthew 6:33, Jesus says, this is well into the Sermon on the Mount. He said, don't worry about what you'll wear. Don't worry about what you're going to eat. Your Father in heaven knows that you need those things. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all that stuff is going to be added to you. Good advice from the Master. Above all else, seek the kingdom of God and righteousness, his righteousness. And he'll take care of you. He'll take care of your finances. He'll take care of your needs. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all the rest of that stuff will be added to you.
Thank you.
glory of the risen Lord. Who can compare with the beauty of the Lord? Forever he will be the Lamb upon the throne. I gladly bow my knee and worship him alone. I will reconcile man to God. Forever he will be the Lamb upon the throne. I gladly bow my knee and worship him alone. Forever you will be the Lamb upon the worship you alone.
In the book of Philippians, chapter 2, it says, every knee shall bow. Every knee above the earth, on the earth, under the earth, and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. I can't recommend highly enough that you bow your knee to him and worship him before that day comes, because at that time it will be too late. Thank you very much, Lyle. Thank you very much, Lee. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. And may the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In Jesus' name, amen.